Welcome to the Rent Prep for Landlords podcast. And now your hosts, Stephen White and Eric Worrell.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Rent Prep for Landlords. We've got a special episode today as we have a guest in the office on episode number 280. How you doing, Steve?
Good, Eric. How are you?
Good, good. And I know when I say how you doing, Steve, people might be thinking Steve White, but this is Steve Fox. So, Steve, how did we get introduced? Was it a friend of yours, correct?
Yeah, my friend Lindsay in Nashville was listening to the podcast, and I actually was too. And he asked me if I knew about it. I said, yeah, I checked it out. And he said, you should be a guest on that. And I was like, yeah, sure. Okay.
Yeah, it's funny how that works out. Yeah. Well, you actually own property. How far would you say it's from here over the border?
Oh, we have a place in Crystal Beach, Ontario. Yeah, it's actually, well, from where we are now, it's a little more, but from downtown Buffalo, it's 12 miles.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, really close.
Yeah, so you did some international travel today to be on the podcast,
right? I did,
right?
I did.
That technically counts, so that's pretty cool. But just getting to know you from talking on the phone before when we had a conversation, really interesting backstory. I'm sure a lot of our listeners will find it interesting.
Oh.
You have pretty unique path into real estate and getting into real estate investing. So your upbringing and where you've gone in life from if your Wikipedia page, because you're enough of a celebrity that you have a Wikipedia page. I do not. Where you grew up in Canada, right?
Yeah, in Vancouver, on the West Coast, yeah.
Okay, and then why did you move out? You went to Toronto. Why did you head out to Toronto?
You know, all through high school, we're starting way back now, but I'm an older gentleman, but it was in Canada. Toronto was really the New York of Canada, and if you're a sort of artistically bent in any way, you know, Toronto was the place to be, and all through high school, I was just couldn't wait to graduate and get out to Toronto and do art of some kind. I still paint. I paint pictures and sell paintings, but it was really music, and I started a music career pretty right out of the gate.
And with that music career, would you say that kind of blossomed when you moved from Toronto to Nashville, or like
Definitely.
What did that look like?
Well, I moved to Nashville when I was 32. And so I gave it a really good run in Canada and kind of, you know, went through a couple of major label record deals that kind of didn't go anywhere and kind of found myself back in the bars. And I had great years through my 20s in Toronto. It was a vibrant town, really lively live music scene there. And I did well, you know, I had bought a house in Toronto at the time, but I could see the end coming, and the whole live music thing was dying. And people were telling, you know, I was writing a lot of songs that were just kind of pouring out of me in different styles. And people were telling me, well, Nashville's kind of the place where you can get an actual like job writing songs for a publisher.
Okay.
And so I started making trips down there and pecking away at that and co-writing with people. And it took me a couple of years of trips back and forth. And then when I did move there with my brand new wife at the time, I had a publishing deal to go to. Yeah.
A publishing deal, like, is that something where you get a year, or like, was it a contract or like?
Yeah. Yeah. It's really, they're a little bit like snowflakes, the deals, but they're sort of a template. And that is, it's a staff writing, songwriting job. And, you know, they gave me an office and a guy that I worked with, it was a song plugger, and he would kind of help me with my calendar because I didn't really know a lot of people. And he would sort of set me up with people to co-write with.
Okay.
And you're on a salary, but it's not called a salary. It's a little bit complicated, but it's called a draw, and you're good for a year, and then you revisit it, and each year after that is called an option, and that option is not yours, it's theirs.
Okay.
To renew you or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any particular artists or songs that your listeners might be familiar with that you've written before?
Well, I've had quite a few interesting things as a singer and a performer and a producer, lots of producing and recording engineering and stuff. But as a writer, I guess a group called Montgomery, Gentry,
mm-hmm.
I did well with the song. I had a single on them early on called Daddy Won't Sell the Farm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's on YouTube. And I have lots of videos of me on YouTube. Not that I want to direct people to those. I certainly look better in them than I do now.
I was checking out the Montgomery Gentry song before you got here, and I went down into the comments. And it's pretty interesting reading them, because really, I've never really thought of it this way, because usually when you're, you know, watching an artist on YouTube or something like that, you're paying attention to the artist, not necessarily the lyrics and the person behind them.
Oh.
And obviously, because I knew you're coming to the office today, I was singing the lyrics, and that everyone's, you know, quoting the lyrics from the songs in the comments, which is kind of neat. But it was also one of those things where you could definitely tell that it was a very like identity-based song, where the people that were quoting it were probably, you know, either were from farms or grew up in that kind of area, because they were like, this is our country, this is our type of place.
Right.
Like they were, you could tell they really connected with the lyrics, which is
Well, you know,
neat.
What's interesting is that I did not grow up on a farm or anywhere near a farm.
I was going to ask.
But I did draw from, you know, and the many times that I've been asked where I drew, you know, the lyric from for the song.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a real estate story, come to think of it. In my years in Toronto, it's a short one, I'll tell you, and you can use it or not, but in my years in Toronto when I was playing clubs and all that through my 20s, in the Yonge and Eglinton, Yonge and Egg area in Toronto, there was a famous house. I mean, there were people walking around with t-shirts with this house on there, and it was just out of you could not create that for a movie set. It was crooked, it was old, rotten clapboard, it was gray. It was a two-story house that, and you look at it and you can see the whole story, because there was a parking lot on one side and sky and huge buildings. It was downtown. This is clearly some old geezer who does not want to sell his house.
Mm-hmm.
And
so it was like this kind of almost tiny house with these brand new builds to buy it, and just the one guy kind of who didn't want to sell the farm, so to speak.
Yeah, and I was going to a dentist appointment sometime in my 20s, and I parked my car right by it. Old rickety picket fence, and he came out and chopped wood as I was getting out of my car. I never said anything to him, but he was 15 feet away from me.
Yeah.
Chopping wood. He looked like he was 100 years old.
Yeah.
And this guy had just held out so long that he became kind of an urban legend, only it was all real. It was just amazing. It's gone now, but his name was Cromwell. There were people walking around with t-shirts, Cromwell House, and this cartoony.
Yeah, it was kind of like almost one of those inside, not jokes, but just like things that only you knew about if you were in that neighborhood kind of thing.
Yeah,
yeah. No, that's
so
really cool.
I sort of drew from that when I was writing Daddy Won't Sell the Farm.
That's really interesting. We don't have a ton of guests that come into the office, but one of a different guest we had come in. His name's Dr. Roger Firestein. He's a creativity professor in Buffalo, and he talks about how you kind of can draw from these different experiences.
Sure.
Where in your case, you know, you probably weren't thinking you're going to write a country song about selling a farm from observing that, but you're able to draw back to it, which is pretty cool.
Absolutely.
So you're doing well in Nashville. You're writing, you're producing, you're singing, doing all of this. What point did you decide to get into real estate, and how did that kind of start off for you?
Oh, yeah. Well, I was really lucky to have a few years where we all of a sudden my income was like, it's where did this extra zero come from?
Mm-hmm.
And my wife and I are not... We're not, you know, we liked our house, and we don't buy jet skis and toys, and we were a little bit like, you know, what do we do with this money?
Mm-hmm.
And so we
you're not big on lifestyle creep.
Right. And and so we started buying houses with the money I was making in those years, and I knew that those years were not going to last, and they didn't, you know, and that's cool. I had a good time, and but we literally were buying. We bought, I think, our first 9 with the money I was making. And now that's not to say the houses in Nashville were cheap.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've been there 22 years now, and I can safely say the first 14 years there was was like no appreciation to speak of at all. It was just not what we were doing. We were buying them to rent them out, and it's incredibly cheap, especially when the downturn hit and we bought a bunch more. And we thought we were done at like 9 houses, and then we bought a bunch more in the downturn. Mm-hmm. And now all of that is over. It's really good, really gone up quite a bit. We look at stuff, and I don't know how people can make the numbers crunch at all. You know, buying them and paying your payment, your whatever payment you have, property tax, insurance, and maintenance, and then rent them out, and there's just nothing left.
What's your, like, if you're looking at your typical rental house that you maybe would be looking at in a different market, actually, you're putting an offer in Buffalo today, right?
Yes, we are. Yeah.
So you're looking at, did you say it was around 200,000 and it's like, what, 2,500 square feet or something?
It's 2,300 square feet, and our offer today is 210, yeah.
Yeah, so something like that you're looking at in Nashville, what are you looking at price-wise?
Well, of course, again, it's area-specific.
Sure.
Not nearly as much as Buffalo. I'm really noticing Buffalo, you go a few blocks over there, you can buy a house for $40,000. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen in Nashville. But that the house, we've got an offer for 210 in Nashville, in an area like that, or like a really nice area near Elmwood Village, is where it is, comparably would be like East Nashville, and it would be probably three times that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe 5.5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So at what point, like, did you hit a point where you, I'm assuming you're still involved with music, right?
I'm actually really kind of ramped out of it in the last few years.
Okay.
Yeah. And we've got, you know, we're up to 18 properties right now. And like I say, we're just probably going to buy the one more. We always say that, but
yeah.
That's what we're doing here in Buffalo, which is new for us. We don't own anything else in Buffalo. Actually, interestingly, we found a little niche in our own area in Nashville. And when I walk out my door, within a mile, I can go to 12 of my houses.
Oh, wow.
They're all just in the same little village called Old Hickory Village. And so that's kind of like our wheelhouse.
So when you started investing, it was kind of more so like, what do we do with this extra cash? Then you start getting into it, and I'm assuming enjoying it and really liking this as an investment tool. Did you have that point where you started thinking, you know what, if I want to leave music, at least professionally, I can do this now? I mean, when did that conversation at least start internally, or, you know, when did those conversations start?
Yeah, that's pretty accurate. There was kind of a dovetail, you know, a whole bunch of years where I was really doing both. I was still really busy producing and traveling and singing and writing songs and all of that. And we had bought a bunch of houses. And we also have three boys that are growing up, almost gone now. But and those were some busy years, you know, and some of those houses we gutted right to the studs. And that was a learning curve for me. I was kind of handy. I'm more handy now. There's an awful lot of people out there that are a lot more handy than me. You know, there was some very, very busy years. And then I just kind of got burned out on the music thing and really enjoying the real estate more and more. So as we bought more houses, I was kind of doing less music. Mm-hmm. And probably within the last 5 to 7 years, I've ramped right out. I'm actually out there playing bars again a little bit because it's incredibly fun.
Yeah.
And
that must be like such a change of pace from like when you think back to your years when maybe you were, you know, 20s playing bars and you're trying to figure it all out and what you're going to do and where you're going to go. And now you're just kind of doing it because it's fun, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's incredibly. The difference between being in your 20s and playing and not knowing your future and really everything just being a question and to where I am now, what was a total grind at one time is now like some of the most fun I have. I don't do it a lot, but mm-hmm. I mostly in the summer around Crystal Beach and, you know, when we're family and friends are up here. I do it a little bit in Nashville, but not much.
Yeah. So I'm curious as far as like, I think you brought this up before, and I know this doesn't have a lot to do with real estate, but personally, I'm curious, You said that you come up to Crystal Beach every year. And is that kind of like your time to get away and just kind of reset kind of thing?
Oh, yeah.
And I guess when you told me that, I thought maybe it was kind of more for like a creative process kind of thing, or do you just kind of use it just to kind of have downtime?
It's funny you mentioned that, because I mentioned that to you earlier that I paint pictures.
Yeah.
And I did that as a child. I was really into that and thought, you know, art mm-hmm. in that way, you know, painting. And I didn't really do it again until about maybe 7 years ago. We've had our cottage for 14 years in Crystal Beach, and we spent all summer there. We mm-hmm. just like literally relocate for the whole summer.
Okay.
And I have a little shed, and I paint, and I do art shows, and I sell them, and it's just, I mean, I love it.
Yeah.
I just love it.
Do you have...
So it is a creative outlet. I mean, it's not a big money maker, but
sure.
it's an awful lot of fun.
Do you happen to know Terry Crews's? They used to do these Old Spice commercials, really big guy, and he like kind of make his like pecs jump, and he does a whole bunch. America's Got Talent, if you've ever watched that, he's the host of it. I'm trying to think, Brooklyn Nine-Nine is a show that he's on.
Oh.
Anywho, I got to give you a podcast that he's did on the Tim Ferriss Show, if you're familiar with him. But this guy ended up making the NFL and then doing an acting career and all these crazy things.
Oh.
But art was always his thing that got him through. So this person that everybody knows as being this huge, I mean, defensive lineman, like just absolutely huge guy.
Okay.
He actually got out of Flint, Michigan on an art scholarship. And like, it's just a really interesting story.
I know. It's just like, you know, I'm not really, and when you see my paintings, some of them look like a little old lady painting them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very strange thing, but I just really enjoy it.
Yeah. Well, I think it's cool for our listeners, because I'm sure some of them are either, you know, just getting started or maybe in the middle of their journey with real estate, and to listen to somebody who's kind of gotten to a place where you can enjoy things like sitting and painting in the summers,
yeah.
you know, and mm-hmm. you're not necessarily bound to trying to make money with your different forms of art, but
right.
doing it because it's a passion and something you want to do is awesome.
Oh, I've been really lucky. I mean, even the music, I would like to tell you a story of lean years where I didn't know where my next dollar was going to come from, but I really never went through that mm-hmm. because, you know, I just was, like I said before, I'm not into crazy toys, and you know, I never needed a great big, you know, square footage house to sort of, or a car to sort of like remind me of how amazing I am or any of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I just had my head screwed on right from an early age, and I always made money. I always made a good living in music, you know.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, everybody's story is completely different.
Yeah.
At how they arrive at the real estate thing, it really is amazing.
Yeah, if you had a piece of advice either for yourself, if you were starting over but knowing what you know now, or somebody who's getting started themselves, I mean, from your experience of going through your real estate journey, what would you tell someone?
Oh, well, having three boys, I'm used to giving advice like that, and that's just whatever it is that you do. I'm repeating an old adage, we all know it, but if you find something that you love, you'll never work a day in your life. There's nothing more pertinent to someone's life and happiness and their trajectory than that saying, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I've just been so lucky to have that ratio of my job that I despise being very small all my life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And not having to go to a job that I 80% can't stand, you know.
Yeah, it's interesting listening to your story, because I feel like probably a lot of our listeners and people who do real estate investing might be in that job they can't stand, and they're hoping that this is going to be that vehicle that gets them out of it.
Right.
Where you kind of just went like, oh, like, why don't I try this? And then all of a sudden you got out of it, but it wasn't because you hated what you were doing. You're just transitioning
right.
and changing. Yeah.
Very true.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think, you know, from what I've seen, the people who do the best at it seem to find an area or a niche that they learn really well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like our situation, we own a condo in Florida, you know, stuff like, there's little stuff like our cottage in Canada. But for the most part, everything we're doing is in Nashville, and more specifically in our area. And we really have come to know that area. And, you know, I think there's something to be said for finding a little pocket of real estate where you really learn to understand it and you can really do well.
Yeah. I'm sure you can walk into a house in that little area in Nashville and you know within 5 minutes whether or not it makes sense or not.
Right.
So, yeah.
There's a guy in Crystal Beach named Phil Smith, who's a real estate agent. He was the youngest. Now he's in his early 40s. He was the youngest real estate agent in Ontario at 19 years old. And now he's just the man in the – and he specializes in Crystal Beach. Mm-hmm. I mean, Ridgeway too. But really, he was there when the town was really, you know, struggling. And now it's rebounded incredibly and the houses are really way too expensive. But all these little cottages he was grabbing up for, you know, $30,000 and fixing them up. And now he owns restaurants and he owns the main strip, you know. He's just the guy. He's a great guy. And he just – it's a quintessential example of that, a dude that found that one, you know, area and specialized in it and did really well.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for stopping in for the podcast.
Thank you, Eric.
It's interesting hearing your story and for traveling from another country to be here today.
Right. You know? Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Steve.